Welcome to Prophetic Rewind. This is a series I've put together of amazing, incredible moments with my dad, Kim Clement, over the years. In our vault, we have a treasure trove full of stuff that my dad's done over the years. Everything from him traveling to churches, incredible worship, prophecy, teachings. I have so much that I can share with you. And so welcome to Prophetic Rewind and enjoy.
See, a promise is stagnant until there is a divine enlightenment and God breathes on it. And then your vision has a voice. Your promise gets a voice. And when it pleases God to reveal His promise in you, that I may preach His promise in me. Sometimes it has to wait. Habakkuk chapter 2 verse 3 says, your vision is yet for an appointed time. The dream that you have, there is an appointed time. Listen to me. And it says, but in the end, or the other word is, in the fullness of time, it shall speak. It shall have a voice. And it will not lie, though it tarry. And I looked up the word tarry, and many of you have been Harry Tarry. We've been standing around waiting, and we don't know why it's taken so long, because it has to become, give a voice first. And so, tarry, it's an old English word. It means to delay in acting. It means to linger. It means to rest or to wait. Even though that vision has been dormant, it's been waiting, it's delayed in action. He says, wait for it, because it will surely come. It will not linger forever. The word that I got from God when I was praying this afternoon was, He said, tell them, it pleases me. He said, and a lot of people will understand what that means. It pleases me to reveal their promise so that they can communicate it. In other words, I'm going to give their vision a voice. I'm going to give their vision a voice. Jesus in Luke, the Bible speaks about Him first and foremost being led, driven by the Spirit, to be tempted by the devil for 40 days and for 40 nights. He remained without food, and when he, God, as man, was in his weakest form, Satan came. Let me tell you something, he never comes when you are at your highest level. He knows the power of your kickability. He knows that faith will drive him into a very humiliating place. He waits until your faith has been drained. He waits until you have no confidence in that thing. That's why the Apostle Paul and many others prayed that you would restore my confidence. He says, come boldly to the throne of grace. How many of you have been coming to the throne of grace on tiptoes and afraid? Because you've sinned or you've done something wrong. And that takes it away, because Satan knows when you don't come in like this to the throne of grace, you are scared, you're afraid, and he's ready to attack you. But when you get up and realize it's not by your works, but by the blood of Jesus Christ, and you walk into that holy place boldly, he won't attack you. He's a fight. Measured, to be paid. Are you with me?
Yeah.
Can you imagine the days that they preached you're supposed to be like a worm? You're just a miserable sinner saved by grace. And you must come crumbling to God. And yet we are in 2008 saying these words. Don't lose your confidence. Come boldly into the throne of grace. Let me tell you, there are ancient forces of darkness that are saying, oh God, will she shut up? Because their posture decrees to satanic forces what your spiritual level is at and where your faith is. So even if you're going to act, do it. Jesus is at his weakest moment. 40 days, 40 nights, no food. You can imagine the voices that came to him. What then he must have thought of himself. You know what it's like when you've got no one encouraging you. Then the power of hell comes to him. God in his weakest form. This is going to happen once. It's going to happen twice. It's going to happen another time. He has the habit, Satan, of coming when you are at your weakest. Even in his weakest as a man. God is a man at his weakest. Still was able to stand up against the power of hell. Quoting scripture boldly and putting him in his place. You need to understand that boldness is a requirement for you to resist the powers of hell. When you come to God, stop moaning and complaining about what you've done wrong and why you can't make it right. Stop thanking him. Because I found the power of praise. Come on now. The power of praise knocks away every force of inferiority because, my friend, it's not about you, it's about him. If you are the Son of God, he says to him, if you are the Son of God, then turn these stones into bread. Jesus is not going to force a work under the pressure to prove who he is by a system that has been around since the beginning of time. If you do that, you're already under his control. I go into a meeting, I don't say, I better watch out what I play and what I sing. I do what I do in my bedroom, I do what I do in my prayer closet. You're never going to kick the powers of hell. I promise you. And you ain't going to be a prophet. So, Jesus stands there and he says, and you've got to understand something. He could have turned the earth into a meatball and eaten it up right there. Christ could have done whatever he liked. Now I must turn little stones into bread. No, I think I'll do a better job. And when God desires it, and when there is a need, I'll take some water and I'll turn it into wine. You understand what I'm saying? When something runs out, don't look for it. God will create something out of nothing. That's a fact. Let's get to the point, because tonight I want your vision to get a voice. Because it is the appointed time for certain of you to be moved into the next dimension. And you cannot go there until you have that voice that will make declaration. So there we go. Jesus stands there. Weak. 40 days, no food. You know what it's like. You can't stay a day without food. And it's like fainting and dead. All kinds of things. You've got a few around here that do that. She's actually not here right now. I'm going to die. Now after a day, 40 days, 40 nights, a voice comes. Bread to stones, you know you can do it. Delicious. Italian bread. Jesus resists him. Easily. Man shall not live by bread alone. I have lived for 40 days and 40 nights by every word that has proceeded out the mouth of God. You cannot live off yesterday's truth. You cannot live off revelation that was given yesterday. You can can survive, but to live, you must be hearing God's words every day of your life, and the words that proceed out of his mouth must be what you eat, must be giving you your nourishment. Satan don't like that. He says, okay, you're on the pinnacle of the temple right now. Cast yourself off, for it is written. Oh, yes, you're going to quote scripture now. Religious spirits are great at quoting scriptures. Hello? Come on now. Cast yourself off. Now we get to business. Jesus now realizes this guy is stupid. Honestly stupid. You get too much credit, Satan. I was telling my kids the other day, they were scared because they saw something. I said, you know, we talk about the fears and the problems. Why don't we talk about the big things that God does? Let's talk about that now. Let's talk about David standing before a giant. And he looks at him and begins to prophesy. Boldly. Not with fear and trembling. He stood and the Bible says he ran for the giant. There is a new dimension of boldness that's coming upon the church that we have lost. Stand before God with boldness and make one declaration that you'll soften his heart. I come to you with the blood of Jesus Christ in my heart, and I come to you knowing that your son died for my sins, and boldness takes you to the next level. Come on! Everybody, there's a spirit of boldness. You say, what is that? The lion. The lion in you has risen. Don't you think this is just a good old preach? This is a spirit. This is a spiritual force.
Dust. That is not what dunamis means.
It is a power that is controlled by authority. If you have power without authority, you are like somebody in a boxing ring that just punches away and has no strategy. Authority is the ability to control the power that you have. You gain authority. You are given power. Authority comes with character. As you go through things, as you acquire certain levels through overcoming in life, you gain authority. Whereas 25, 30 years ago, and I'd be put before a presidential candidate, I would have gone in there shaking and said, "Thus says the Lord." You. Now I know how to control the power that has been given to me. It was a boldness to say what I had to say. I went into a concert of a very famous artist once years ago, and they heard that I was there. I came late because I had to do a meeting first, and I walked in and the cameras were there. They called me up and they said, "He wants you to pray with him and give him a prophecy." I walked on the platform and grabbed him by his neck and said, "The curse has been broken," and I walked off, and these were the words he said as I left. "Is that all?" When you've learned that sometimes too much said has less effect when it's not under the controlling force of dunamis. Now understand this. And so, I'm saying this to you tonight to show you what Jesus did. Understand, he had not yet become a voice. He was the living word. He was known as the son of a carpenter, Joseph's little boy. That's who they knew him as. Now he's been in the front, he has been face to face with a force that brings humanity to nothing, to dust. And so, Jesus now finally, Satan finally realizes, okay, you're the Son of God. I'll tell you what I'll do. Instead of you dying on a cross and having to suffer whatever for this, there are the kingdoms of the world. I'll give them to you if you would just bow down before me. I don't know if you know the principle of bowing. The Bible says when you bow before an image, you become likened to that image. Had Jesus Christ bowed to Satan, he would have died. Now I know you all say, "Well, God cannot die." I understand. But if God himself would have taken that step, he was bowing to death. He was bowing to hell, the grave, and would have taken on the image. You say Jesus would never have done that. He was tempted. Remember, these were temptations. What Satan was saying was, don't go the course that God set you on. We can just nip it in the bud right now, stop it, and you can do something to gain the kingdoms of this world. Because right now, the kingdoms of this world are controlled by Satan then, at that time. Jesus knew there was only one way that redemption only came through the shedding of blood, not the bowing of the knee in surrender. This is an old age-old way of gaining victory. He went to the cross. He was in his weakest form on the cross, and hell itself was tormenting him. And in his torment and in his pain and in everything, while he was dying, he could stare in your face, Satan, by turning to a thief, crying out. And as Jesus was dying, he snatched one soul and took it with him into heaven. My point being, in his weakest state, he had the boldness and the power to say to a thief, "Lord, remember me." He said, "Today you will be with me." And as he died, snatched one more out of the hands of Satan. Understand the power of our King and our leader. That's why I follow him. That's why I love him. That's why I serve him. He's the grandest and most amazing in the whole wide world. And I love him. Ever say I want to tell you quickly about this. I'm pulling up something I'm going to share with you, but this is the issue. That God, Jesus, said to him, "You shall worship the Lord your God, and him only will you serve." And off he went. And the angels ministered to Jesus. Now, if you listen to me, you'll understand. Now, the vision, the word, gains a voice. He leaves there, and in Luke it tells us that he goes into the synagogue. And in the synagogue, he stands up, and the prophet Isaiah has been opened. He stands up and he reads, "For the Spirit of the Lord is upon me." And you know the whole scripture. "For he has anointed me to bring liberty to the captive, to open the eyes of the blind." He reads the whole scripture. And he walks down and sits down. And the people look in amazement. Is that Joseph the complaint? Isn't he making little wooden little things, chairs? And they've attached themselves to his past. Because there's no voice. Yet. All he's done is he's reached. But something has happened to Jesus in that dark moment with Satan. Jesus stands up. He says, "This is me. That what Isaiah said is me." Suddenly says, "And you know what you're going to do?" And he goes through the whole thing. "You're going to say this with him on the cross." And the spirit of prophecy takes over. And the vision becomes a voice. And the same people that call him the little gracious little carpenter's son stand up and try and kill him. Now when you've got a voice, remember something. They want to kill you. You go read it one day. When Jesus Christ suddenly opens his mouth and says, "That which I read is actually me in this time and in this space." And if you can find your time, your appointed time, open your mouth and speak it out. Even though you have those that will try and fight you, you open your mouth because it'll draw God's power and take it to the next place.
Of grace,
you shall see your future in a glimpse. For the spirit has been willing, but the flesh has been weak. Therefore, the disillusionment, disenchantment, not to speak. God said, you are to open your mouth. This is the time and the season. Now I will speak to you in direct terms, for I trust you. Whenever I come to this pastor, I didn't want to call him a pastor. I think he's more than a pastor. Not so much more. To your church, I say this every time. The celebration of the people that you give me, the boldness to do what we do, which we could not do in a lot of places, allows God to say things that are mysterious to some and will always remain in a parable. But no, not to some, others. He will speak boldly. Moses knew the ways of God. Israel knew the works of God. Some people only recognize God when he works.
Thank you so much for watching this week's Prophetic Rewind. I know you were blessed. I'm always blessed when I have the privilege of going back and watching Kim. And, you know, one of the things that's so beautiful is that the Word of God is timeless. It's outside of time. And so these words that God gave Kim to speak are still alive and living and active, and that is a beautiful thing. And I know that in Donnie's heart, what she wants to do is carry forward with her father's vision, her father's legacy. And, you know, Prophetic Rewind is one of the ways that we are doing that, that she is able to carry that forward. Code Breakers is obviously another one. Her Secrets podcast is something she started, and you can find that on the iTunes store. Please go subscribe and review it for us. But being able to carry the legacy and walk forward in her dad's footsteps is a really big, big thing for all of us. And I just want to encourage you. You know, God is totally aware of every single one of our needs. He is well prepared for every eventuality that happens. And I know, because I've done it in my own life, that even sometimes in my place of greatest need, in my place of greatest turmoil, when I've sowed into my future in faith, I've seen incredible results. And so I just want to encourage you. In Luke 21, 1-4, we read the story of the widow who brought two mites into the temple treasury, and Jesus was standing watching, and he saw lots of people bringing bags of money, and that wasn't what impressed him. What impressed him was the heart of this widow who gave everything she had to give, even though man would have looked at it and said, it's such a tiny bit. But to Jesus, he said, she gave everything. And so when we appeal to you like this and encourage you, it's not a pressure thing. It's to say, hey, God sees you. He sees your heart. He sees your needs. He's willing and able to meet you where you're at. But it's for us that we give. God doesn't need what we've got. We need to give, because we need what we need to give for ourselves and for what God's got to give us. So I really encourage you, sow with faith into Prophetic Rewind. Just mark it off that that's what you're sowing into. Prophetic Rewind, Code Breakers, The Secrets Podcast. And there's so much more that's in Donnie's heart, that's in the pipeline, getting ready to come. And I'm excited for the future, excited for what's going to be coming out of her life and her heart. And just to see Kim's legacy furthered and continued, and see us continue to walk in his footsteps. And obviously, the future that God's got for all of us. God's got a future for you. God's got a future for me. And together, united, there's something awesome and unstoppable that we're able to accomplish together when we're united in faith. And so let me encourage you, give and know it will be given back to you, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. God bless you.